The Delano Paul Award went to Matthias Taub and the number 10 Gessler. His teammate shares the front row with him. This is the first tier Master Cup Series race at Darlington in 8 years, and there's quite a few interesting news items entering this race. First of all, Zelda Ashby's time penalty from the round of Russia was overturned, meaning that Ashby is now back in the championship chase. So we'll have to see if Ashby can make a good run of things tonight. Concerning the results of the previous race, the round of Wales, a final decision will be made on that in between this race and the round of Quebec. And Greg Woodard and Lycoya have both been playing some great PR for it. However, I don't think too many people are convinced in their sincerity. The last news item is a much more pleasant one. Former two-time TM Master Cup Series Drivers' Champion Alexis Rainsford recently won the Indianapolis 500. Rainsford started from the middle of row 3 and sort of hung around in the top 5 before making a final charge at the end of the race and ended up victorious. Rainsford is here this weekend. However, she is mostly here to support her husband, Chris Davenport, who drives for Alert. Dan, off to you. Thank you, Lance. The two Gesslers lead the field to the green flag. Matthias Taub in car number 10 gets a pretty good start over teammate Arto Kekkonen and the rest of the field. Coming into turn 1, Matthias Taub in car number 10 is stretching a bit of an advantage here. Both the Gessler drivers have not won a race this year. Matthias Taub won at Sweden last year, and Arto Kekkonen won 3 times in 2012. But the two Gessler drivers just not having any luck finding their way into victory lane, but pace is certainly not a problem for them. In car number 29 this week is Austin Howard. He is the son of 3-time Master Cup champion Joseph Howard. Austin Howard replacing Chris Johans in this car because Johans is driving the third Volpe. Howard works for Manicor Engineering as one of their fabricators, but he's hasn't really run anything major in quite some time. He ran in TM Lights and the ASCC before, but he hasn't really had a whole lot of luck this week. As I mentioned earlier, Chris Johans is in the third Volpe, car number 14, and he's in this race with the promoter's option. He's running in fourth place. This is what I was hoping to see, Chris Johans in a competitive ride, because he certainly is one of the faster drivers on the circuit. He's running in fourth, as you can see right there in that white car. Teammate Leonard Roderick right behind him. Packer Carroll in the number 2 Volpe. Oh, not having as much luck early in the race. He came very close to getting a Darlington stripe here. But Packer Carroll in the number 2 Volpe is, well, he's really, one seems to wonder whether or not that Volpe's just putting Chris Johans in that car to get the best out of Packer Carroll. As I alluded to during the coverage for the round of Wales, Ian Cooper might change the paint job on that 777 car if the Blackhawks won the Stanley Cup, and well, I think that says enough. In fact, he's got that red and black car out for tonight, says enough. He's running in 14th in that car. He's been fairly quick all weekend, just nothing spectacular from Ian Cooper. As you can see, the back of that car, we're on board with Chris Davenport in car number 6. Davenport in a special paint job for this race. The sugar-free launch. So anyways, as Ian Cooper gets around the 72 of Kevin Dwyer, who's had a pretty good weekend himself, and Chris Johans does likewise. Paul Lyons is back in the 44 car. So is Dan Lechleiter back in the field in the Tenere, car number 47. Nick Dawson, the 58 car, is right there going by Lyons. As you can see, the racing line at Darlington very close to the wall. The inside line will not get is not nearly as quick as the outside. Also, Craig Janser in that green car number 89. And so far Wales winner, Greg Woodard in the 41 right there. And there comes Ryan Matthews in the 61 of the shot in the Aspira as Lyons comes really close to knocking the wall down. Luciano Savarol in car number 3 is running up in third. He's doing just as fast as he was last season, but he just hasn't had any luck. He's almost won twice this season, but on both occasions, he was taken out by a Volpe on the last lap. So I think Savarol is just a little worried about having a Volpe around him at the end of the races. He kind of lets Leonard Roderick go by, and he's getting freight trained here. I think Savarol may have a bit of a problem in that car, or as, oh, Ian Cooper in the wall a little bit in the 777 car. So the EFR Journey driver having a little bit of a rough start to this race. Oh, he's got a problem. He's got a lot of problems with that 777 car. He's probably got a tire going down or something like that. And, we got the yellow out for that. That's interesting. Granted, last night's TM Lights race was nothing short of a caution fest, but I think that's a little trigger happy with the yellow flags there. Anyways, Cooper got the 777 car back to the pits, but he was two laps down. Luciano Savarol leads on the restart in car number 3. Matthias Taub, as you see, sits back in second as the running order appears on the left side of the screen there. Taub in that 10 car is really looking at Savarol. And I wouldn't be too surprised if we saw the Swede really challenge, but Zelda Ashby in the 55 has other ideas. In the FPO car, gets stuck behind Cooper right now. And Cooper really being a bit of a nuisance right now, but he doesn't really have any other options. Davina Henton, the championship leader, is running back in 21st, and Henton just does not like this racetrack in this this number 11 car. She's just hasn't really come to grips with the how this track runs, and Kuznetsov, way out of shape in the 8 car. But Davina Henton not exactly having the best of weekends, so we'll have to see what she's able to make of this. She's, as I mentioned, leading the championship, and some of her championship rivals could really capitalize on tonight. Speaking of capitalizing, Gaspar de Souza is running in 12th. But Black Diamond Racing is not expecting to run well here because their cars just do not seem to be reacting very well to the transition from the racetrack to the pit lane. It sounds like they just missed the setup really badly with all 3 cars. Of course, Gaspar de Souza's 2 teammates, Peter Short and Paul Lyons, not exactly having the best of the starts to their evening. As Ashby is leading the race with her active time penalty from Russia overturned, she's back in the title hunt, but Matthias Taub goes right on by and takes the lead back. The Russia winner, Yelena Sovas, goes right on by. Roderick's right there, and that's Kurt Pliskin right behind Roderick in that yellow and purple car. Kevin Dwyer, car number 72, he's running back in 13th place. Kevin Dwyer is he's had a decent weekend going so far in the 72 car, that's a jinx right there. As smoke billows out the back of the 72 car, and a big disappointment for all the Kevin Dwyer fans, he goes out on lap 14. Pretty much at the same time, this is going on in the back of the field. Scott Stoiler had a bit of a problem, and that's also going to be terminal. He was running back in 32nd. Kurt Pliskin is up to 5th place right now. And, it's not really a surprise that both Kurt Pliskin and Powerster Incorporated are in full support of Greg Woodard keeping the win at Wales. At the moment, it looks like that might be the... Pliskin into the wall! Lewis Kingston going to have a run on him. But at the present time, it looks like that Woodard might actually keep the win at Wales. And there's some people that aren't very happy about that, especially because there are some people crying politics and the like, and I think there might be something to that, but we'll just have to see what becomes of that. Adrian Devereaux in car number 1 is, he was sent to the back of the grid for a altercation after being taken out by Craig Mummert at Wales, and what I mean by altercation, I mean a shove. Kevin Dwyer told me that he would have punched Craig Mummert if he was Adrian Devereaux, and that apparently sent Adrian Devereaux a guide on how to actually throw a punch, but regardless, Adrian Devereaux was not exactly happy about his penalty. But Leonard Roderick going by Matthias Taub, it looks like, or he's going to have a run on him. Scott Bates in that black and gold 88 car sitting right there, ready to pounce. Scott Bates has been pretty fast all throughout the weekend, just didn't exactly qualify where he would have liked. Gaspar de Souza looks like he might have gotten into the wall in the background. So Roderick in car number 4 is gonna take the lead right now. Scott Bates, Yelena Sova, and Arto Kekkonen look like they're pretty much holding station. But as you might have noticed, the top 6 have really pulled away from the rest of the field. Bates having a run on Roderick as Roderick slides way on the outside. And right behind Taub is Lewis Kingston in the moto, having a great weekend so far and a great start to this race. But Lewis Kingston is kind of running all by himself. He's not really able to reel in Taub, but he's left everyone behind him. Anthony Griffith in another Tenere is running in 25th, Ryan Matthews in 26th, and that's Jim Davidson, the TM Lights driver in the 222 car running in 27th. Davidson starred earlier in the season at Carbondale. He's an independent trophy driver, and he's having a good start to his race. Anyways, Matthias Taub running in 4th. As you see, he's got Zelda Ashby in front of him, Nasova and Bates have Lewis Kingston all over them, as Jim Hayes in car number 36 is driving for Tom Delgado's team. There's been a lot of inner turmoil at this team, but it's more due to bad circumstances, as Tom Delgado himself, the team owner, is not here due to the health of his father declining, so Tom Delgado not in attendance, but that team is giving everything the giving their all for this race with Jim Hayes. And they're running in 29th, not exactly the best of weekends for him, as Peter Short in the 22 car scraped the wall. Yeah, Peter Short's car appears to have really gone south, and, well, Jim Hayes trying to make the best of it. Paul Lyons in car 44 is running back in 33rd. He's reporting a serious push condition on that car, and that might have been because he's gotten into the wall once or twice, but it doesn't look like he's gotten much damage on the right side of that car. Arto Kekkonen is now the race leader in the number 9 car. The Gesslers, as I mentioned earlier, have not been able to break through into victory lane, but the Gessler drivers are still running at the front of the field as they usually do. Arto Kekkonen, not as much as he was last season. I would still wait before I judge their whole season, even though we are coming. We're closing in on midway through the season. Kekkonen is he's been fast. He's just not had a whole lot of luck. Here's another driver who hasn't had a whole lot of luck. Luciano Savaro, back in 8th. We recently learned that his contract is up at the end of the year, and Hodges Walter Racing is keeping their options open. So, Luciano Savaral, there is some people thinking that he might be out of this car at the end of the season, but that Hodges Walter Racing wouldn't exactly let him go for anybody. Adrian Devereaux's contract is also up at the end of the year, but Devereaux and Hodges Walter Racing are working on an extension, but I think as of not too long ago, he's allowed to explore other options. I don't think Adrian Devereaux is actually going to be doing that. I don't think he would be leaving this team anytime soon. And all indications are that Adrian Devereaux will probably resign for this team within the next couple of weeks. Well, here's another driver that we're not really sure about when it comes to the silly season. The silly season puzzle is Chris Johans. Where are we going to see him? The FARC, the newly merged Arla and Falconer championships. Over to Nemoto, over to Volpe. Regardless, I'd say he's doing his case, he's doing himself a lot of good with this very strong run in the Volpe tonight. Chris Johans, car 14. Hopefully, we'll get a couple more outings in another competitive ride. Whether or not it's more outings with Volpe or what have you. Evgeny Kuznetsov in the Carnivore 8 is running in the points in 19th place. He's upped his game significantly since Karjala, and it looks like now that he's been able to get the same amount of funding to this 8 car as Nesova's had, that Kuznetsov has really been able to challenge some of the... has really been able to go into uncharted territory for him. Nick Dawson, car number 58, is pitting a little early on lap 33. This is, I do believe, his last Independence Trophy start, so Dawson needs to make the most of tonight, and haven't exactly seen a whole lot of that. Not exactly had a good weekend. Michael Sykes and Adrian Devereaux battling hard for position. Sykes goes a little high on the racetrack. Michael Sykes is still... Michael Sykes did hit the wall there. Kurt Pliskin in the 16 car going to have a run on the Welshman, and Lewis Kingston in the 17 car does as well. And you can tell how much that scrape of the wall not only killed his momentum, but might have actually hurt the car a little bit. Luciano Savaral coming by in that green car number 3, as in the second of the Altairs. There's some talk that Michael Sykes might hang up his driving helmet at the end of this season if he's able to win one of the major events in the calendar, or win the championship and become some sort of competition director at Alert. But left, I'm gonna hold judgment on that. Oh, Savaral into the wall as Chris Johans really begins to make some headway in car number 14. He's running back in 12th right now, as he's chasing down Michael Sykes in car number 5. This 14 car really... Oh, D'Souza hard into the wall in the background. He will have definitely damaged the car there. Kingston in car 17, that's textbook perfect right there. Just goes right around Kurt Pliskin in that 16 car. Daniel Lechleiter has pitted the number 47 Tenere. He was supposed to be running a Lycoya this season, but Lycoya and Lechleiter had a bit of a falling out in their relationship, and that's why you see him in a Tenere. So, as he rejoins the track, has not exactly had the most luck in his Independence Trophy campaign, but luck is something that's always sort of escaped Lechleiter. Austin Howard in car number 29 has been caught by the leaders, and we're going to see how much grace of a back... Oh, whoa, Arto Kekkonen not playing nice with Austin Howard, as Howard gets kind of shoved up into the high line, where he's not been terribly comfortable. Nesova in the 7 car gets by him. Scott Bates is going to go right on by Howard. There goes Ashby in the 55, and then Roderick at the back of that chain as Howard, gets out of the way. Arto Kekkonen, the race leader, is going to pull down into the pit lane on lap 37. This is a scheduled stop as Taub, his teammate, sweeps over into the lead of the race. And it looks like Howard into the pit lane as well. Matthias Taub in car number 10 has stayed out. In the 10 car, looks like the rest of the lead pack has. Luciano Savarol is into the pit lane. Johans is into the pit lane. It's one of the Lynx cars in. I think that's Melanie Klebno on her way out of the pit lane, actually. Adrian Devereaux into the pits. The rest of the field in on lap 38. I see Kingston in. Pliskin. Henton in the other Lynx car. Car number 11, Packer Carroll. Chris Davenport in the 6 car is in. And Scott Bates in the 88 car was the last car to hit the pit lane. So Scott Bates throwing the dice a little bit with this car. And we'll see how well that's going to pay off for him. Ryan Matthews in the 61 also appeared to stop a little late. And Matt Taylor back there in the background in that blue and white 15 car. Whoa! Scott Bates is going to emerge in second with Zelda Ashby as the running order on the left. You can see right there where your favorite driver is running as Scott Bates and Zelda Ashby are going to be duking it out for second behind the lap car of Alessandro Rossini, who's, to be fair, Rossini's holding his line as Ashby into the wall. Or maybe not. Actually, I think Ashby might have gotten away with that one. That was close. Anyways, Rossini holding his line, letting the leaders go by as one of the cats is into the wall in the background. Daniel Lechleiter is running in 11th, and Anthony Griffith, the other Tenair, is back in 18th. So the two Tenair is having a pretty good run so far. Lechleiter in this 47 car, I think, could use a little bit of luck in this series at some stage. And here's Anthony Griffith, as he was voted into this race with the promoter's option. We might see him later in the season with this car at Ohio, because, of course, a lot of Tenair's corporate offices are in Ohio, as Michael Sykes, back who's dropped all the way back to 19th, goes around. Oh, Griffith into the wall! As Michael Sykes goes right on by Griffith in that 07 car. So car number 5, the red 5 of Michael Sykes, is on his way back towards the front. Matthias Taub didn't exactly have the best pit stop. He's chasing down Scott Bates and Zelda Ashby in that gold Myasoft car number 10, as Bates and Ashby are working on the lap car of Ryan Matthews, while Taub's teammate Arto Kekkonen is leading the race. The Swede is didn't exactly have as good of a pit stop as his teammate. Could have been because Arto Kekkonen had a much cleaner pit lane than Taub, didn't have as much traffic to get through. As Ryan Matthews, that's going to be a Darlington stripe for sure, as Jim Hayes into the wall in the background as well. As Scott Bates and Zelda Ashby now trying to work on Ben Atkins in the 50 car. Luciano Savarol is back in 17th place in this number 3 car. Despite the fact that he's been contending for those, he was in contention for 2 wins earlier in the year. Savarol has otherwise not been a little bit more anonymous than I expected. He was involved in some on-track controversies last season, but we haven't even seen a whole lot of that, other than those 2 instances where Volpe took him out in the last lap while leading. At halfway, Arto Kekkonen, car number 9, has a very convincing lead, as he has just put Jim Davidson and Peter Short, looks like, a lap down. So Arto Kekkonen having a easy time here, it looks like, at Darlington. But still got a long ways to go, and anything can happen here, as Kekkonen, car number 9, holds a substantial lead. Dale Roswell is running in this race in the midnight instead of Yamino Tenshi. Roswell will be running in some of the American races with the midnight car. He's running back in 28th. He's a lap down, and that's kind of what you get when you have a very experimental car that's not exactly the most reliable. Engine failure. Lewis Kingston is hanging around in 7th in that 17 car. He's had a string of DNFs lately, and he's on his way to a very strong points haul. Between Lewis Kingston and his teammate, Troy Adams, Adams has actually been able to keep up with Kingston in the points department, but Lewis Kingston just seems to have that edge in speed. Adrian Devereaux is really charging to catch Leonard Roderick and Zelda Ashby, and he's back in 6th, despite the fact that he started 2nd to last. Melanie Klebno started in last, and she was sent to the back of the field after that incident in pit entry at Wales, as he goes by Leonard Roderick and now sets his sights on Zelda Ashby. Adrian Devereaux is trying to do something that no one has ever done before, win 3 TM Master Cup Series Drivers' Championships in a row, as Ashby gets a little bit sideways there. No one has ever won the Master Cup 3 years in a row. Adrian Devereaux could be the first to do that, and he's been in contention to do so, but been in contention to do so all season long. Leonard Roderick in the four car almost went three in a row in the early 2000s, but failed to do so at the dying stages of the season. As Devereaux and Roderick are running down Gaspar Souza, who is a lap down, that double zero team looks like they had to repair some damage on that car, and that certainly hasn't helped his case, as Paul Lyons continues to fall back to the field. As Devereaux now has caught Matthias Taub and is going to try to get around the Swede and chase down Scott Bates in the 88 car. This one car is really, really hooked up tonight. He almost actually would have won the Delano Pole Award, as Arto Kekkonen has hit the pits on lap 65. As I mentioned earlier, Adrian Devereaux could have taken the Delano Pole Award and started at the back of the field because of his qualifying lap. It would have qualified him second otherwise, as Jim Hayes, the 36 car, big Darlington stripe on that car, but thankfully that car is already black, as Troy Adams in the background has also found the outside wall here at Darlington to be very accommodating. That is Anthony Griffith in the 07 car right behind him. And Davina Hinton in car number 11 is going to pull off and hit the pit lane on lap 66. TM Master Cup Series cars don't have the largest fuel tanks around, and I think the fact that they're able to make it as far as they do on one tank of fuel is very impressive. Adrian Devereaux into the pits on lap 67, along with Matthias Taub, Leonard Roderick, Gaspar Souza, who's a lap down, Ashby, Kingston, and Nasova. And one driver I didn't see coming to the pit lane, Scott Bates in the 88 car again, stretching his fuel just a little bit more as he runs behind a couple of backmarkers, Zach Duff and Nick Dawson. Zach Duff having a disaster of a night, and he's been fairly impressive this season as overall. Nick Dawson, that 58 car, hasn't been running too badly either. But, Scott Bates now peeling off into the pit lane as Lewis Kingston now takes a turn of being stuck behind Nick Dawson. And as you can see, the running order on the left shows that Lewis Kingston is in third behind Scott Bates and Arto Kekkonen. And 36 cars still circulating here at Darlington as we are nearing the end of this race. Adrian Devereaux working on Dawson in the background as Kingston holding off Taub. You can see Ashby and Roderick in the background there. As Kingston now trying to work his way around Rossini. Rossini's giving him space, but Kingston just not exactly peeking out and making the move. There he goes. Oh, well, Taub pulls up to try to get a bit of draft off Rossini, but I don't think Taub realized Adrian Devereaux was coming as fast as he was, because Devereaux is going to definitely pull that one car out, and Devereaux makes a dive bomb. Oh, here we go. That could be three wide. That could have been a big wreck right there. Adrian Devereaux, very aggressive right there, but you can tell he's going for it. He's not interested in playing second fiddle to anyone right now. Lewis Kingston doesn't have much to do with him. Devereaux kind of crowds Kingston up into the high side there as Kingston almost loses the back end and into the wall. It got up way into the gray, right up into no man's land. And that's, you can see how much that's hurt Kingston's momentum, because here comes Matthias Taub to try to take that spot away from Kingston now. Taub, car number 10, looking for his first win of the year. Scott Bates in the 88 car is holding a fairly solid second place. He's not really in a position to challenge Arto Kekkonen at the moment, but he's not exactly in a position for anyone to challenge him either. This goes green the rest of the way. I dare say Scott Bates is going to be solidly looking at a podium finish here. Chris Davenport in car number 6 was a driver's wife at the Indy 500, according to him anyway, supporting his actual wife, Alexis Rainsford, who won the race. Rainsford is only the second driver to win both Indy and Karjala. So that's definitely something that Rainsford can pat to add to her long list of accomplishments as a driver. Chris Davenport in car number 6 is looking around Troy Adams. I don't think they're racing for position with each other. Davenport himself has not exactly been setting the world on fire in that alert car. Lynx Racing and Gessler are working on another effort to get Alexis Rainsford to run the Master Cup Series race at Indianapolis later in the year, just like they did at Karjala. Their lead driver, Davina Hinton, is running in 10th, and Hinton has been very much on board with getting Rainsford to run the Master Cup Series race in Indianapolis. We'll see if that actually happens, and I think that would be interesting if Rainsford can try to be the first driver to ever win the Master Cup race at Indy and the Indy 500. Arto Kekkonen still leads the race, but it's actually Chris Johans back in 8th who has the quickest car on the racetrack right now. So Johans is going to be trying to make some headway. As you see, Arto Kakinen has put Greg Woodard, Matt Taylor, and that black car is Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. in got some sponsorship on that car. Chris Johans, as I mentioned earlier, fastest car on the racetrack. He's not really around anyone else at the moment other than Yulian Asova, who is running in ninth. But Chris Johans on this 14 car, very impressive tonight. He's really showing that he can run at the front, and he hasn't really lost anything, but that he just needs a little bit better luck in the pit lane, perhaps. Ryan Matthews is running back in 32nd place in the 61 car. He hasn't really had a good handle of this car all weekend. I think the general consensus in the paddock is that this team embodies the spirit of the Independence Trophy more than some of the other teams, because everything you see on the 61 car was made in-house. So a big pat on the back to Matthews Motorsports for being able to do that, but they just need a bit more luck on the track at the moment. Adrian Devereaux is running down Scott Bates as best he possibly can, and slowly but surely, the Frenchman has been reeling Scott Bates in as he's closing in on Craig Janser in the 89 car, who is has been having a better weekend than it looks on paper in that 89 car. Not a whole lot of money flowing through that team, but they're able to make the most of what they got. Paul Lyons in the 44 car is... Austin Howard into the wall in the 29 car. Looking at Paul Lyons, he runs with Matt Taylor. Oh, contact! Lyons around! After contact with Austin Howard, Lyons was running back in 35th, but he just couldn't avoid Austin Howard. And Howard just, he's being a bit of a weapon out there, seemingly, because that's not the first time he's been into that wall. He's gotten into that wall quite a few times. Austin Howard just went in there way too fast, getting pressured a bit by Greg Woodard, I think, to move out of the way. And Lyons just got into the back of him. Really, Lyons came on Howard so quickly that Howard couldn't get out of the way in time. I think that's what that boils down to. Greg Woodard in the 41 car is out under the yellow flag. Mechanical difficulties eliminate the Lycoya Interceptor from the field. He hadn't exactly been having the best of evenings. Something had been going wrong with that car all race long, and now it's apparently proved fatal. Arto Kekkonen is now in the lead with less than 10 laps to go. He's got a couple of lap cars in between himself and second place Scott Bates, who is a bit further back in the field. However, that's going to put Scott Bates in danger of losing that second place to Adrian Devereaux. Arto Kekkonen pulls away from the field fairly easily on that restart. A lot of lap cars, as I mentioned, are in the way of Scott Bates back in second. And we're looking now at Scott Bates. He's got Adrian Devereaux and Matthias Taub closing on him in a hurry. And he might also have to worry about Lewis Kingston and Zelda Ashby. But Kingston did not get a very good restart, as you can see in the background. Anyways, Scott Bates, you can notice Adrian Devereaux's sort of pale blue and orange car flying in on the inside. There's Adrian Devereaux, car number one. That's the car that Bates is racing for position, and then that golden yellow car of Taub is also the other car that Bates has to be concerned about if he's going to hold on to this podium. He's got second right now, and Devereaux really, really hounding the 88 cars. You see Quiggles Jr., car 99 up there, has got some sponsorship for this race, but he had contact in the pit lane. We're not quite sure with who yet. As Scott Bates slides into position behind Troy Adams, he gets a bit of a run on, gets a bit of a lead on Devereaux. There's Chris Davenport in the sixth car up there. Davenport went a lap down not too long ago, and Scott Bates trying to hold off Adrian Devereaux. And looks like all the lap cars are generally playing nice here. Jim Hayes, Troy Adams, they're all being very, very courteous, getting out of the way, letting the leaders battle each other for position. That's what I like to see. Good gentlemanly driving by Jim Hayes and Troy Adams, as Adrian Devereaux now has a run on Scott Bates, but Bates is now going to use the draft from the lap car of Chris Davenport, using the back markers to his advantage, and, well, Chris Davenport's not exactly moving out of the way. I think Davenport will do so now. Davenport's staying, holding his line. Scott Bates peeks out to make a move on him, and we're on the white flag lap. Adrian Devereaux makes a move on Scott Bates, flies hard into one. Adrian Devereaux really stuck his nose in there and just went full on it. Scott Bates had to back out of it just to avoid getting put into the wall, and he lost two spots as a result of that. Further back in the field, looking at Ben Atkins in the 50 car and Packer Carroll in the 2 car. As Ben Atkins gets hit by Packer Carroll, gets hit again, both cars into the wall, and Ben Atkins spins down the back straightaway. In car number 50 on the final lap of the race. Meanwhile, back at the front of the field, Arto Kekkonen in car number 9 has run pretty much the last two-thirds of this race unopposed. He's been winless so far this season, but he takes his first win of the year here at Darlington. Arto Kekkonen, car number 9, scores Gessler's first win of the season in a dominant performance. The Finn had a very, very easy time out there. Adrian Devereaux, with that last lap dive, takes second. Matthias Taub rounds out the podium by basically following Adrian Devereaux through. Scott Bates in the 88 car. May not exactly be very happy with that move Devereaux pulled on him, but despite that, that was a very, very good drive by Scott Bates. Lewis Kingston, a solid points run in fifth back there for car number 17. Zelda Ashby, Leonard Roderick, Michael Sykes, Luciano Salvarol, and Yulia Nasova complete the top 10. And as you go back on the right side column, you'll notice Chris Jahan's solid run. Both the Lynx drivers had good runs. Melanie Klebno from the back of the field to 14th. Points for the Tenero and Anthony Griffith Sands. Chris Davenport in the 6 car netted some points along with Troy Adams. And Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. ran very anonymously tonight. And he nets the final points paying position. And the Drivers' Championship leaving Darlington looks like this, with Davina Hinton still leading, but that's only a 3-point lead over Adrian Devereaux and an 8-point lead over Michael Sykes and a 28-point lead over Arto Kekkonen. So the championship has really begun to tighten up. Zelda Ashby is in the hunt again, along with Matthias Taub. Melanie Klebno has had a large string of points recently. Gasper D'Souza, his form has fallen off just a little bit, but that whole team has sort of fallen off just a little bit. I think Black Diamond Racing is really looking forward to getting onto another road course. Yulia Nasova, Leonard Roderick, both having strong seasons so far. Roderick in that 4 car, I think, could be poised for some more points if he gets the win from Wales back. Scott Bates having a decent season so far in the 88 car. Kurt Pliskin and Luciano Salvarol tied on points, but of course Pliskin has a win, so he gets the tiebreaker. Peter Short in the 22 car. Peter Short's had a strong season so far. He's very solid, very consistent. The only problem with Peter Short is that Gasper D'Souza just is really been able to get a better hold of that car quicker than he has. Yamito Tenshi hasn't even run that many races. She sits 15th in the championship. Greg Woodard, at the moment, tied with Kevin Dwyer in the championship. Zach Duff. Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. is having a solid season for a rookie. I do believe Quiggles Jr. actually leads Rookie of the Year, but we'll have to check on that. And Lewis Kingston in car number 17 rounds out the top 20 in the championship. Now that we're close to halfway through the season, let's have a peek at the Independence Trophy standings. Mike Durbin on 200 leads the Independence Trophy, but that could change depending on what happens with the outcome of the round of Wales. Karpinko still second. He's going to be second, I think, no matter what happens to Ike Durbin's points total. I would go back and look at Craig Yonser, Ryan Matthews, Dan Lechleiter, and Jim Davidson, all of whom appear poised to make a massive jump in the standings if they have a decent run. Matt Taylor in the 15 car didn't really have the best of runs tonight. Friedrich Jaeger got that pole position in Sweden, so I think there could be some more speed from the Wernströms. With Jaeger at the wheel, anyways. Frank Azure in the 46 car could do with a bit more luck. We should be seeing him relatively soon. Tom Moore, of course, nearly won the Independence Trophy last year. Don't count him out. One name you may not see on this list is Alex Harrison Racing in the 0 car, last year's Independence Trophy winners. They are set to make their first start of the season at the next race, the Round of Quebec at Road Gatineau.